I'm the co-director of the Center for Neural Bases of Cognition, and I'm also in the psychology department with David. And I think of myself as a bit of an academic curmudgeon, because I tend to like to shake things up in the field, because I think a lot of the field is broken and is breaking more all the time, the way we do science in particular, and the way peer review works. And I'm going to start with a little bit of a story, and this goes back to the mid-90s, and it actually isn't about academics, it's about politics. My wife and I used to go to a long weekend every winter break with a group of very high-level people within the Clinton administration that were mimicking Renaissance Weekend, if any of you remember what Renaissance Weekend was, but they weren't invited quite to that, but they were next echelon. And we were the only academics that ever went to this. And one of the years, I remember very distinctly, we were having a discussion about getting the next Democratic president elected and what the mechanisms were going to be. And my wife and I said, well, there's this thing called the internet now. And the internet's going to change the way you all do politics and the way you campaign, because you're going to be able to reach and communicate with people and disseminate information in different modalities than you ever have before. And NATO, one, looked at us like we were crazy. And we actually had a raging but friendly argument for like the rest of the weekend about the impact of the internet and whether it would really fundamentally affect their lives or politics in any way. Okay? And I think we're about at that point in academics. Whether we like it or not, the way the internet and the way information is disseminated within academics is going to fundamentally change. It already has, but it's going to change a lot more. And there's nothing Science Magazine, Nature Magazine, or from National Academy can do about it. Okay, it's partially a democratization, but it's also just market forces and a variety of other things are going to lead to that. The least of which, of course, is squeezed university budgets. And also further congressional oversight on academics to the point where they're going to force open access to everyone anyway, because it's the taxpayers' research. And so my attitude is, if you're going to publish, why not publish in open access? Because the way people are going to consume information in the future is going to be typing into Google and finding out where the information is. And if you're open access and it's well indexed, they're going to find your research. And that's your colleagues too. It's not just the public. Whereas, for instance, I recently had to find a paper from the 1960s. The American Psychological Association owns the copyright. It turns out that Carnegie Mellon, for good reason, does not pay for articles that far back or whatever for this journal. And they wanted like $15 for this 1960s article. Now, this is ridiculous. I mean, come on. This is a dissemination of information. Therefore, I did not read nor cite the article. Okay. So I think, first of all, it's an imperative if you really want 20 years from now people to care about any of your work. It should be in some kind of forum in which you can we can access easily. And I think that ultimately it's a better way to get that information, because we are already completely inundated with information. And the nominal curation of journals is really just a nominal curation of journals. We can agree that there's both good and bad papers and quote-unquote high-quality journals, and then you take supposedly second-tier journals. I mean, not the sham journals that are where they're asking you, you know, come publish with us and pay us whatever it is. But we can agree that there's second-tier journals nominally that have very good articles, sometimes much better than what we see. And I think that you asked about this science article by John Bohannon. It's entitled, Who's Afraid of Peer Review? He basically sent out, I don't know how many of you have heard of it, he sent out this paper that was a sham paper. It's not the first time this has been done. It was done in the 60s by psychologists. It's been done since then. And to all these open access journals that are these for-profit ones, not things like PLOS or Frontiers, and lo and behold, it got accepted at most of them. Well, this is not a surprise, because anyone who has half a brain in their head knows that these journals exist, and that's how they work. And they existed before the web also. There's a journal called Psychological Research you might have heard of, published out of Germany, that was always pay for play. Okay, so, but he acted all high and mighty, and Science wrote this very self-serving article about why this is such a terrible thing and how we should have peer review. Now, I have to tell you, knowing some people that have edited Science for different points and talked to them and knowing something about the internal process, sometimes they look at the name of the author, because it's not double blind, and they go, oh, that's going in because they've got the Nobel Prize. And the most egregious version of that, there was a paper published by a Nobel Prize winner, Linda Buck, that had to be retracted because all the data was faked by her postdoc. Whether she knew that or not, who knows. But the fact is that everyone in the field had said that that data was too good to be true from the day it was published, yet Science thought it was wonderful. Okay, it clearly did not undergo normal peer review. So I'm very skeptical that for-profit journals and journals that are closed access are going to survive in the long run in the current model. They're going to have to change or they will die. I think journals like Science and other journals that are published by society should be ashamed of themselves for not going open access right now, because they're societies. We own them. I'm a AAAS member. Why should I have to pay, or why should my university ever have to pay for access to that, or the public have to pay for that, given the mission of that society? And I know societies say they need the revenue. Well, Societies don't exist just for the revenue. Okay, so I really feel that really strong. And then there's a last reason, which David alluded to, which has to do with speed of publication. So I'll tell you one last story. I have a friend at Brown University who's a physicist, and 2 weeks ago he did not win the Nobel Prize. He was one of the three guys that didn't win the prize for the Higgs boson, but was on the other paper. Okay, now most people that know these papers tell me, and I have no way of evaluating this, that it was at least as good, if not better, quantitatively than the papers that won the Nobel Prize. But it came out 3 months later. Jerry tells me it was purely an accident of the publication vagaries because no one knew. So all these papers got submitted about the same time. They all went through the process. But the journal that his appeared in had a slightly longer lag in publishing things. And it ultimately may have cost him the Nobel Prize. Because if his paper had been out first, well, what are they going to do? So I think that's really important to remember that sometimes also spinning your wheels going back and forth in a traditional publishing model, which, as David said, in psychology can take years. And then even after it's accepted, it can sometimes take years to actually appear in print, believe it or not. And I know that there's other fields like that. If you can get things efficiently out there and you think it's high quality and you should keep the quality high, but it's out there and disseminated, then you can go and you can do better and more work than you could possibly do by wasting your time arguing or spinning your wheels on something else. So I think that's really important.